Recorded Books and RB Digital present The Soul of an American President, The Untold Story of Dwight D. Eisenhower's Faith by Alan Sears and Craig Osten with Ryan Cole. Narrated by David Cochran Heath.
Faith is the mightiest force that man has at his command. It impels human beings to greatness in thought and word and deed. Dwight D. Eisenhower, Address at the Second Assembly of the World Council of Churches, Evanston, Illinois, August 19, 1954. Introduction. It seemed like just another day in Washington, D.C. The nation's capital was buzzing with activity as people from across the nation and around the world visited the monuments honoring the heroes of America's past, Washington, Jefferson, and Lincoln. Yet at the White House, things were quiet as Fred Seaton, the current Secretary of the Interior, arrived for another day's work. As he entered the White House, where every president except Washington had resided, Seaton, like so many others, might have reflected on the history that had taken place in the building. It was here that Lincoln paced the halls, often late at night, during the bloodiest days of the Civil War. It was here that other presidents, Madison, Polk, McKinley, Wilson, and Franklin Roosevelt, made the difficult decisions to put young Americans in harm's way. For each of these leaders, these decisions were never easy, were always costly, and often had worldwide impact. On this particular morning, Seaton stepped briefly into the Oval Office. Here he encountered something at once extraordinary and commonplace, something that shocked him, but at the same time made perfect sense. He found a man kneeling in prayer beside a desk. However, this was no ordinary man. This was arguably the most powerful man in the world, the President of the United States. The secretary, embarrassed by his intrusion, quickly pardoned himself and left the room. However, as he went about his work that day and each day following, Seaton was heartened by knowing that the President, facing a difficult and complex decision about sending troops to the Far East to deal with another potential international crisis, was on his knees. Was the secretary's discovery the stuff of fiction, as some historians like to say? Apparently not. According to Seaton's account, this episode unfolded one morning in 1957 during the presidency of Dwight David Eisenhower, or Ike. In January 1953, just days after his inauguration as the 34th President of the United States, Ike stepped out of the White House to make his way to the historic National Presbyterian Church on Connecticut Avenue. The temperature was in the high 50s. Despite the spring-like air, Ike's wife, Mamie, had come down with a nasty cold and reluctantly agreed to stay home. So Ike walked the few blocks by himself to do something many men are reluctant to do without their spouse, attend church. Designed by famed architect Henry Hobson Richardson and constructed in the 1880s, the decade before Ike's birth, the magnificent church possessed a long spiritual heritage. The history of the congregation went back much further, nearly to America's founding. In fact, the congregation's first worshipers, a group of Scottish stonemasons building the White House, met in a much humbler location, a workshed on the grounds of the Executive Mansion. The church membership had grown well beyond those five artisans and their workshed. When he stepped through the doors that morning, Ike knew he was joining a congregation with a long heritage that had seen most previous United States presidents attend worship services and much American history unfold. Several other presidents, including James K. Polk, Andrew Johnson, Ulysses S. Grant, and Benjamin Harrison, had been part of the congregation. In the church's previous building, parishioners had heard Frederick Douglass preach passionately from its pulpit on the need for all men to be free. The church's pastor at the time, Reverend Byron Sunderland, was an abolitionist who also served as chaplain of the U.S. Senate during the Civil War and was a friend of Abraham Lincoln. The pastor of National Presbyterian Church in 1953 represented a different period in American history. Dr. Edward L.R. Elson was a former U.S. Army chaplain who had served under Ike during World War II. On this Sunday morning in late January, as he sat directly behind former President Benjamin Harrison's old pew, Pew 41, Ike listened to the words of Dr. Elson as he talked about Saul of Tarsus, better known as the Apostle Paul, whom Dr. Elson said, encountered the living Christ and was transformed into a crusading evangelist of the gospel. It is impossible to know exactly what Ike was thinking. Perhaps he was struck, as he listened to Dr. Elson speak, by the similarities between his own life path and that of the apostle. Ike's had been a winding path, starting in abject poverty first in rural Denison, Texas, and then in Abilene, Kansas. The path had not always made sense, at least in human terms. Ike had left the dusty plains of Abilene for the U.S. Military Academy at West Point, where he found the classes repetitive and sometimes dull, but where he also discovered his life dream, to lead troops defending liberty into combat to fight for freedom. However, after graduating from West Point, he found himself shuttled from one seemingly meaningless Army assignment to another, kept from fulfilling that dream. In the midst of these ongoing professional disappointments, a deeply personal and tragic family loss would strike and leave a deep mark on Ike's life, a mark that never fully healed. Just when it seemed that Ike's life was on a fixed course of trivial assignments and relentless disappointments, historical events intervened. The explosion of World War II transformed his life. And with its outbreak, it became immediately clear that through that string of disconnected military assignments, foreign exiles, and bypassed promotions, Ike had been uniquely prepared to lead the greatest military endeavor of all time. Unbeknownst to him, during the years when he felt he was being ignored and passed over, many influential leaders were taking note of his competence and faithfulness. When he finally began receiving meaningful assignments, such as playing a leading role in the Louisiana maneuvers in preparation for entering the war, his exceptional leadership resulted in Ike becoming Supreme Commander of the Allied Forces in World War II. Ike would soon command the respect of the nation, starting him on a journey of service that would eventually land him in the White House. When Ike received news of his fifth star at the beginning of the Battle of the Bulge, he remarked to his colleague and friend, General George S. Patton, "Every time I get a star, I get attacked." Ike was probably referring to the thundering of German guns in front of him, to the rattle of the American media behind him, and to the attacks from Allied generals working alongside him. But Ike remained a man faithful to his conscience and to the core principles of duty, faith, and perseverance that he had learned growing up on the streets of Abilene. Ike's image, manipulated and oversimplified to fit a preconceived narrative, has met the same fate as so many other great leaders. Nowhere is this more evident than in scholarly and popular portrayals of Ike's presidency and his personal Christian faith. In the decades immediately after his time in the White House, many historians and commentators painted a picture of Ike as a great general during the war, but a lethargic, doddering grandfather during his years in the White House. The perception was he would rather play golf and paint with watercolors than deal with the social upheaval occurring in the southern United States and the international turmoil of the Cold War 1950s. Only a year after Ike left office, Arthur Schlesinger Sr.'s poll of American presidents ranked Ike 20th among his peers, near the bottom third of the men who preceded him, among such lesser lights as Millard Fillmore, Chester A. Arthur, and the impeached and barely acquitted Andrew Johnson. As time went by, however, the historical events that unfolded cast a new light on Ike's decisions and leadership. His reputation began to improve among historians, while the image of the lethargic grandfather receded. By 1996, when Schlesinger Jr. issued his new rankings, he described Ike as an astute, crafty, confident, and purposeful leader, and ranked him number 10, just on the cusp of joining the greatest presidents. A 2017 poll saw Ike's standing rise to 5th, citing his moral authority as his top asset, landing 4th in that particular category. The only presidents who received higher rankings were Lincoln, Washington, and the two Roosevelts. The first major scholarly re-examination of Ike's legacy was The Hidden Hand Presidency, written by Princeton University professor Fred Greenstein in 1982. Examining the long-term effects of Ike's presidency, Greenstein refuted the perception of Ike as a disengaged and reluctant president and instead revealed him as a perceptive political strategist and effective leader. Other biographers followed suit, including the late Stephen Ambrose, scholarly writer Jean Edward Smith, acclaimed British journalist Paul Johnson, and former Newsweek editor Evan Thomas. These authors unanimously described Ike as a wise, cagey, and successful president. While Ike may not be on Mount Rushmore, those who know history now recognize him as one of America's most revered and untouchable figures. Both the left and right have used Ike as a political football to advance their respective agendas. But people on both sides of the partisan aisle now remember Ike as a president who successfully navigated the challenges of a booming post-war America, wisely assisted the emerging civil rights movement, and perhaps most significantly, provided balance during the ever-looming nuclear threat of the Cold War. It may have been that threat of global destruction that caused many Americans to look toward God for comfort and support during the 1950s. That decade was the high-water mark of American religious engagement during the 20th century. According to a 1957 Gallup poll, 69% of Americans believed that religion was increasing in its influence on the country's culture. In contrast, 60 years later, only 22% feel the same. During the 1950s, almost half of all Americans, like their president, regularly attended a church or synagogue. By 2017, that number dropped to 36%. A survey conducted in 1954 found that 9 out of 10 Americans believed in the divinity of Christ. In 2017, only 43% believed in Christ's divinity. Alan Sears' mother told him the story about the night of Ike's election on November 4, 1952, when Alan was just 1 year old. Television was still new, and the Sears family had yet to purchase one for their home, so they had to listen to the returns on the radio in their bedroom. As the evening wore on, Alan's parents lay awake, with Alan between them, until 2 o'clock in the morning to make sure the results were certain. When it became official that Ike had won, Alan's father was really glad, as he had been in the Army during World War II and was confident that America would have solid leadership. 3 hours later, with victory assured, Alan's 9-month pregnant mother went into labor and gave birth to his baby sister 4 hours later. Throughout the 1950s, Alan's father spent his days keenly aware of the threat of nuclear war. In 1959, he left his job teaching science in public schools and joined the faculty of the Office of Civil Defense Mobilization Staff College, which was then under the executive office of the president. Its successor is now part of FEMA. The agency, created by President Eisenhower's reorganization plan of 1958, was responsible for the preparedness activities of the federal government and for assisting other governmental units. Mr. Sears would remain in this job until his retirement, and the Secretary of Defense would recognize him for his service to the nation. His job was to teach people all over the world how to prepare for and survive a nuclear attack. He worked with governments, armies, and ordinary citizens, teaching them how to duck and cover, how to build shelters, what to place inside them, and how to live together in the event of a catastrophe when a group of people would crowd into one of those cramped shelters and seek survival in a nuclear holocaust. In one of the official U.S. government manuals his father helped write, Alan found the following statement. During the period following nuclear attack, religious worship and prayer would be useful to people in a fallout shelter. That statement matched the tenor of Ike's presidency. Religious faith was a critical element of American society, and something that should be encouraged rather than discouraged. Though there is disagreement among scholars on this subject, there is a strong argument that Ike played a central role in nurturing a nationwide spiritual awakening. Throughout his presidency, Ike was a professed man of faith, perhaps rivaled only by Ronald Reagan with regard to public proclamations of that faith. Ike was also the only president to open his inaugural service with a prayer he wrote on his own. He talked openly and frequently about his reliance on prayer. He regularly expressed his belief that religion calmed the terrors and uncertainty of the atomic age, and he said that divine providence guided the nation's very founding. He was never shy about sharing his convictions about the key role played by faith in the growth and development of society. On the other hand, Ike's faith was personal and very private. He was not evangelistic in the modern sense of the word, and not thought of as someone who actively proselytized. He did not promote any particular denomination, despite his choice to worship in a Presbyterian church. Instead, his statements often seem to reflect less of a proclamation than an assumption of faith. Several statements made by Ike during his presidency reflect this assumption, as well as the lack of his endorsement of any particular form of belief. In 1952, shortly before he took office, Ike declared, "Our government has no sense unless it is founded in a deeply felt religious faith, and I don't care what it is." According to Ike's grandson, David Eisenhower, he was referring to our nation's Judeo-Christian heritage. This was also in line with Ike's other religious pronouncements, which he kept neutral and ecumenical. As one historian noted, Ike's faith was seemingly moderate, tolerant, simple, and firm. One of the ways that Ike helped reestablish this civic faith was to encourage and approve Congress's action to insert the words "under God" into the nation's Pledge of Allegiance. After Congress passed the resolution in 1954, Ike explained why he felt this was so important. "In this way, we are reaffirming the transcendence of religious faith in America's heritage and future. In this way, we shall constantly strengthen those spiritual weapons which forever will be our country's most powerful resource, in peace or in war." Ike also used faith as a rhetorical weapon against communism and the aggression of the Soviet Union after World War II. He laced his speeches with language, positioning religious faith as America's true advantage over the atheistic Soviet Union. Just 1 week after assuming the U.S. presidency, Ike, addressing the students in his farewell speech as president of Columbia University, described the Cold War as a war of light against darkness, freedom against slavery, godliness versus atheism. Ike's faith was more than mere platitudes or vague beliefs that religion was good for society. His faith compelled him to stand against injustice, to change people's hearts, while also seeking to secure peace. During his presidency, Ike saw the rise of the civil rights movement as African Americans in the South, unjustly denied the freedom they were promised after the Civil War, joined together to push for desegregation and receive the freedom to which all persons are entitled. He chose to take a measured approach that he hoped would change hearts and minds and minimize civil unrest. But he agreed with those calling for change that the ultimate objective was a society in which all experienced equality under the law, no matter the color of their skin. And when forced to it, Ike showed himself to be a man of action. When the governor of Arkansas tried to use the state National Guard to deny African Americans their civil rights, Ike cast aside his quiet approach and took decisive military action. Further evidence that Ike's faith was not just for show came from his choice to defer his baptism until after his inauguration. 1 week after his first Sunday attendance, on February 1, 1953, he would be baptized and formally join the National Presbyterian Church as a member, a step he had deliberately postponed until after the election, as he did not want to give any sense that he was using his religious life, an intensely personal thing for him, for political gain. He had seen others whose public piety seemed to increase as election day grew closer, a phenomenon that continues today. Instead, on that February morning, Ike knelt on a prie-dieu, a prayer desk in a small private room, acknowledged his faith in Jesus Christ, and received baptism through the Presbyterian tradition of sprinkling. On that day, Ike became the first head of state known to be baptized in office since Clovis I, the first king of the Franks, who converted to Christianity in AD 496. From that day on, Ike attended church regularly, whether in Washington, D.C., Augusta, Georgia, Denver, Colorado, Palm Desert, California, or Gettysburg, Pennsylvania. He also opened all of his cabinet meetings in prayer and developed strong relationships with religious leaders, such as Billy Graham and Cardinal Spellman. Despite Ike's very public expression and practice of faith, some have doubted his authenticity. Senator Matthew Neely of West Virginia was perhaps the most vociferous, arguing that it was cynical and disingenuous for a president who had not belonged to a church before his election to attend every Sunday after his inauguration. William Lee Miller, a journalist and speechwriter who later served as head of the University of Virginia's Religious Studies Department, took issue with the total lack of what he called social philosophy in Ike's vague view of religion. In 2012, historian Jean Edward Smith, author of Eisenhower in War and Peace, cynically asserted that Ike allowed himself to be convinced that the United States was a Christian country. For these critics and others, Ike understood the political value of public religious pronouncements and grasped that the American people likely would not nominate or elect a man with no formalized religious faith. In their view, Ike cannily rode the prevailing religious mood of the nation for his own political gain. Others point to Ike's well-known use of salty language in times of frustration and his legendary temper as evidence that his faith was only skin deep. But Ike, like every human person, had a sinful nature he would wrestle with until the day he died, and that nature would sometimes rear its head in times of great stress. All of this leads to the question that prompted us to write this book. For years, as students of history, it has nagged us. Was Dwight Eisenhower an imperfect man, like us all, of genuine faith? Or was he a skilled politician who used religion, like so many others before and since, to further his agenda and popularity? As we have read the multitudes of Ike's professions of faith, it is difficult not to be impressed with his eloquence and feeling, as well as the consistency and regularity of his statements. But several of his biographers consistently remind us that Ike was also a shrewd man and a very skilled politician. Thus the question lingered: was Ike's public faith a cynical put-on? In the following pages, we will briefly share some of Ike's life journey from Abilene, Kansas, to his farm in Gettysburg, and what we, along with some associates, have learned from years of detective work attempting to understand the contradictions and confirmations of Ike's faith. There are already numerous biographies about Ike the person, the general, and the president. However, few biographers have discussed his faith. Beyond select quotes from some of his speeches and a few of his public proclamations, this is largely unexplored territory. It is clear from his own words and from the accounts of those closest to him that his faith became an essential part of how he viewed his own life, America, and America's need to respond to the evil, atheistic regimes of the Soviet Union, Mao Zedong's communist China, and later Castro's Cuba. We invite you on our journey to view one of the most consequential, admired, and complex Americans of the 20th century. The one whom Time magazine, in the height of its prime, dubbed on its cover, "The Man Who Beat Hitler," and whose steady hand and faith guided our nation during the frostiest days of the Cold War and beyond. Chapter 1. The Plain People. To understand Ike's spiritual journey and what would ultimately shape his core values and beliefs, we need to trace his faith heritage, the context of his family's faith, and the religious atmosphere of his childhood home. Like that of so many Americans, the story begins several centuries earlier in Europe and travels through a long and complicated series of churches and religious communities. Let's begin our journey in the 16th century as the Protestant Reformation caused great upheaval across Europe. For the Eisenhower family, spelled Eisenhower, only later with the spelling of the name changed to what it is today, the pivotal moment was the beginning of the Anabaptist movement, which became the roots of the Mennonite Church. This religious community would go on to shape the family's faith and eventually result in their immigration to America. The Anabaptists originated in Switzerland in 1525 as a group of radical reformers not happy with what they perceived to be the slow pace of others calling for reformation. They launched a movement to bring about what they believed were more quickly needed changes. They desired a purer church, which in their view meant a church separated from both Catholics and other reformers, such as Luther and Calvin. They also wanted to do away with tithing, usury, and military service, and sought to eliminate the role of the church in civil government while protecting freedom of conscience. The Anabaptists rejected infant baptism and taught that only those who had accepted Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior by their own volition were eligible for baptism. Anna meant again, as many of those baptized as infants who left other churches to become Anabaptists were rebaptized. About this same time, a Dutch Roman Catholic priest named Menno Simons had a crisis of faith. Part of his crisis was rooted in his doubts on infant baptism, differing from Martin Luther, who as late as 1527 and 28 called infant baptism the most certain form of baptism, and John Calvin, who affirmed infant baptism in his 1536 work, Institutes of the Christian Religion. Simons left the Roman Catholic Church and joined the Anabaptist movement. In 1536, Simons, in accordance with Anabaptist teaching, was rebaptized and became an official member of the religious community. In less than a decade, after being ordained, he rose to a place of great prominence in the movement, just as divisions regarding pacifism began to appear in the group. In the midst of the chaos, Simons aligned himself with the Anabaptists, who remained pacifists. According to Simons, the Christian's duty was to suffer, not to fight. He asked, "If Christ had to suffer such torture, anguish, misery, and pain, how shall his servants, children, and members expect peace and freedom as to their flesh?" They eventually split from the greater Anabaptist movement, and Simons became the leader of a group that eventually took his name, the Mennonites. Other direct descendants of the Anabaptists include the Amish and various different forms of Brethren churches. Among those intrigued by Simons and his teachings were the Eisenhower family, a Bavarian name that likely meant iron hewer or iron striker. Although they were technically Lutherans, they started to embrace Simons and his teachings and found themselves caught up in the Thirty Years' War, 1618 to 1648, a violent conflagration that began as a religious war but eventually became a conflict between what one could call the superpowers of that era. These developments forced the Eisenhowers to migrate from their native Germany. Over generations, the family traveled first to Switzerland, then to Holland, and finally, like so many others fleeing religious persecution, to the New World, reaching Pennsylvania in the early decades of the 18th century. Interestingly, another family that made a similar trek across the ocean was the Stover family, who would also play an important role in Ike's faith journey. Records from 1741 document the arrival of two Eisenhower brothers, Hans Peter and Hans Nicholas, in the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania, sailing on the vessel Europa out of Rotterdam. Upon their arrival, they quickly swore oaths of allegiance to the British Crown and the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania. Just a few decades later, despite the pacifist beliefs of Simons and many of the Anabaptists, two members of the Eisenhower family enlisted to fight in the American War for Independence. The Eisenhower family settled in Bethel Township near Harrisburg and joined the Pennsylvania German Society, formed by William Penn, the founder of Pennsylvania. Somewhere around the turn of the century, Eisenhower, H-A-U-E-R, became Eisenhower, H-O-W-E-R. Records show a gradual transformation from the first spelling to an intermediate spelling, I-S-I-N-H-O-W-E-R, to the current spelling. And in 1794, Ike's great-grandfather was born and christened, though probably not baptized as an infant per Anabaptist teachings, as Frederick Eisenhower, H-O-W-E-R. Somewhere in the late 1700s, the exact date is lost, two brothers, Jacob and John Engel, founded the Church of Brethren in Christ, which became more commonly known as the River Brethren. The name probably came about because the church started along the Susquehanna River, and the congregation used the river for baptisms. According to Ray I. Witter, a minister in the Church of the Brethren in Christ and a childhood friend of Ike's, the name developed as the church grew. The congregation spread out geographically, and it became common for members who lived farther from the Susquehanna to say to each other, "Let's go down by the river and see how our brethren are doing." The Ingalls grew up in a Mennonite family, and they incorporated many Mennonite traditions into their new church. Because of this, people perceived them as an offshoot of the Mennonites. The River Brethren's lifestyle mirrored that of the Mennonites. Although internally they were highly communal and close-knit, to the outside world the community appeared stark and plain. The men wore black suits, grew long beards, and covered their heads with bowl-shaped hats. The women wore long black dresses. The River Brethren forbade dancing, drinking alcohol, and gathering too many worldly possessions. They called themselves, aptly, the Plain People. In 1816, Ike's great-grandfather, Frederick Eisenhower, married Barbara, also called Barbary, Miller, a member of the Plain People community. Soon after, he embraced her River Brethren faith, and they raised their family accordingly. Frederick and Barbara's son, and Ike's grandfather, Jacob, was born in 1826. Though the church encouraged its members toward an austere lifestyle, the River Brethren had no prohibition against accumulating wealth in the form of land, and the Eisenhower family did just that. Jacob acquired 100 acres of farmland in and around the town of Elizabethville, located in Dauphin County in south-central Pennsylvania, which, according to Ike, appraised at $13,000 by 1870. Jacob and his wife Rebecca built a 9-room house on Main Street, a house that quickly became the center of activity, not only for Jacob's growing family, but also for the River Brethren. Eventually, the Eisenhower House served as a place of worship for the congregation, and by the middle of the century, Jacob Eisenhower was an active, respected, and influential minister in the church. Walking into the Eisenhower home in Elizabethville in the mid-1800s, visitors entered a large room on the first floor, where a cupboard stood near the door. Instead of holding cups or assorted knickknacks, it was full of hymnals and spiritual books, which received plenty of use from the dozens of people who regularly passed through the home for worship services, prayer, and community gatherings. Jacob led prayer meetings at the house, in both English and German, to accommodate newcomers from the old country. The River Brethren in the area came to hear his sermons, which often stressed brotherly love and practical kindness toward each other. However, Jacob did not simply talk about these virtues. They permeated the Eisenhower family's whole way of life. Another prominent feature of the River Brethren faith was the tradition of giant potluck dinners and church suppers, coupled with sermonizing and socializing. These meetings were much like the modern-day camp meetings, still held by several church denominations, and the Eisenhower acreage was a natural site for many of these well-attended events. Over 100 years later, in his 1967 memoir, At Ease, Stories I Tell to Friends, Ike wrote with obvious respect about his grandfather Jacob. "In my memory, he is a patriarchal figure, dressed in black, wearing an underbeard with upper lip shaved clean." Years later, Ike's brother Milton dedicated a plaque that honored Jacob on the house's front lawn. Ike commented, "My name is in the center of the plaque. This is a compliment I appreciate, but I think Jacob Eisenhower's worth rests far more on his own deeds, on the family he raised, and the spiritual heritage he left them, than on one grandson." The River Brethren were staunchly anti-slavery, but because of their commitment to pacifism, it was difficult for them to give unmitigated support to the abolitionist movement, as the tension and rhetoric surrounding the issue escalated in the 1850s. Although Jacob Eisenhower supported Abraham Lincoln and even named one of his sons after him, he struggled to balance his hatred of slavery with his distaste of violence. And as a pacifist, he decided he could not participate in the war. When the Civil War came to Pennsylvania, Confederate General Richard Ewell's men came within miles of the home prior to the Battle of Gettysburg, which occurred just months before the birth of Jacob's son David, Ike's father. Ike would eventually serve at Camp Colt, the training grounds of which were on the soil where Pickett charged, and later in life he purchased a farm in Gettysburg, where he and Mamie would enjoy their last days. The Civil War also left its mark on the Stover family. Ida Stover, like her future husband, David Eisenhower, was born during the Civil War. But despite the family's shared German heritage, there was a stark cultural difference between them. As the Stovers had settled not in abolitionist Pennsylvania, but in the slave state of Virginia, where they were successful farmers as well. While the Eisenhowers were staunch Union supporters, General Stonewall Jackson and the Confederate Army frequently camped near the Stover family estate. Though the Battle of Gettysburg nearly touched Jacob Eisenhower's farm, the Stovers witnessed some of the worst devastation of the war unfolding outside their very windows. They lived in the Shenandoah Valley, through which Union General Philip Sheridan waged a savage and destructive campaign akin to General Sherman's march through Georgia. The years following the Civil War were hard ones for both families, as they were for many others. Ida's mother died in 1867 and her father in 1873, leaving the 11-year-old an orphan. As the only girl with seven brothers, she went to live with her mother's family, the Links. The Links did not believe that girls should receive a formal education, but required Ida to study the Bible instead, which would result in her becoming a Bible memorization champion, memorizing 1,365 verses. However, Ida possessed a strong will and eventually rebelled against her grandfather's refusal to allow her to further her education. Meanwhile, the international economy faltered. The U.S. government had made a serious overinvestment in railroad construction, which coincided with the German Republic's decision to suspend the minting of coins made from silver, a major U.S. export. These two events sparked the economic panic of 1873, which led to an extended depression that lasted until the end of the decade. This depression had stark consequences for Eastern farmers, like the Eisenhowers and their fellow River Brethren members. Wheat prices collapsed, forcing many of these farmers to look westward and strike out across the continent in search of new opportunities. While Jacob maintained his prosperity, his wealth would be approximately $9 million today, many members of his community were not so fortunate. Jacob's ties to the River Brethren ran deep, and he decided to join his fellow members in their cross-country trek because he wanted to start a new River Brethren colony. Ike said that his grandfather also based his decision to move on the perceived richness of the Kansas lands. He wanted to acquire more land so he could give some to his children to start their own farms, and land was cheap and plentiful in Kansas. Jacob, now in his 50s, was hardly a candidate for a cross-country move, especially with all the difficulties such an endeavor involved in 19th-century America. But he, along with the other members of the River Brethren, had heard about the success of other Pennsylvanians who had made the trek, and they joined the widespread westward migration, drawn by the dream of a River Brethren community on the plains. In 1877, a River Brethren scouting group visited Dickinson County on the eastern plains of Kansas. The group found that land there was affordable, the soil was fertile, and the railroad connected the region to the eastern coast. The River Brethren settled on Dickinson County as the site of their new colony. In 1878, Jacob sold the Elizabethtown farm for approximately $175 an acre and bought land in Kansas for as little as $7.50 an acre. On a cold day in March 1879, Jacob, his family, and the other River Brethren colonists packed all their earthly belongings and headed for the train depot at Harrisburg, the Pennsylvania capital. The group journeyed west in a 15-car train heading to Abilene, Kansas. This was a well-organized venture. The River Brethren community brought about $500,000, or nearly $12 million in today's dollars, to serve as the basis of their new community. Once they arrived in their new home, the colony split in half, with one part settling north of the Smoky Hill River, which snakes through the heart of Kansas, and the second part settling south of the river in Bell Springs, just south of Abilene. The Eisenhowers chose Bell Springs. Meanwhile, 5 years later, Ida Stover, now age 21, received a $1,000 inheritance from her late father, and seeking an education that she would not receive if she remained in Virginia, departed her grandparents to join two of her brothers, who had settled in Kansas. Thus, the saga.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.